Greetings, fellow gorehounds, and welcome back to another blood-splattered vlog. Now, right off the bat, I want to apologize if I sound a little weird right now, because I'm currently hopped up on all sorts of cold medication, because this last weekend I caught a nasty bug and it's been kicking my ass the last few days. Now, as a result of this, my video production has slowed down and I haven't really been doing my live streams that I usually do during the week. But hopefully I'll feel better soon and everything will return back to normal in no time. And with all that bullshit out of the way, let us talk about Takashi Miike's Blade of the Immortal. Now, this is a movie I've been super excited about for two main reasons. Number one, it's a live-action adaptation of the manga of the same name, Blade of the Immortal, which, for those of you who don't know, was about a samurai who killed 100 men in the past, including his sister's husband, and as a result of this evil deed, is cursed with immortality, and thus has to live out the rest of eternity with the guilt of all the people he's killed suffocating him at all times. So he vows to make amends for his evil deeds by killing 1,000 evil men. Basically killing 10 evil men per every one man he killed in the past. Now, this movie makes a bunch of changes to that basic premise, but the essential idea of a samurai who killed 100 men in the past and is now cursed with immortality and must deal with that guilt racking him at all times is still there. The only thing they really change is that in this movie, he doesn't vow to kill 1,000 evil men. Instead, in this movie, he's basically tasked with killing one evil man and all of his little minions, which doesn't really come out to 1,000, so the movie doesn't make a big deal about it. Now, the second reason I was super excited about this movie is because this is Takashi Miike's 100th film. Which, to put that into perspective, Takashi Miike started filming in 1991, which means that from 1991 till now, he's averaged at least 3 or 4 films every year. That is not only insane, that is highly commendable. Now granted, not all 100 of those films are quality films, some of them are complete dog shit. But among those films are some of my favorite Japanese films ever made, between Audition, between Ichi the Killer, between 13 Assassins. It's safe to say that not only is Takashi Miike one of the most prolific Japanese filmmakers of all time, he is also one of the best. So of course I was gonna go out of my way to check out his 100th film, because that is one hell of a milestone. And I am super happy to report that as a fan of both Takashi Miike and the Blade of the Immortal manga, this movie is fucking fantastic. It makes a lot of big changes when it comes to the manga, but never at any point did it feel super rushed like the Death Note movie or the Fullmetal Alchemist movie. And what I liked is that when this movie did do its own thing, it 100% worked. This is the kind of movie where even if I wasn't aware of the manga, I would love this movie just based on the movie alone. And that's good, because that means this movie transcends the very work it's based on. And I like how even though the movie is based on Blade of the Immortal, it's actually taking a lot of cues from Lone Wolf and Cub. And if anyone knows anything about me, I love the Lone Wolf and Cub story, so I was quite okay with that. Now, that's not to say those elements weren't in the original manga, just that they highlight them way more in this movie than they do in the manga. Because while in the manga, the main character vows to kill 1,000 evil men, in this movie, he's basically tasked with just killing one. Because this little girl, who did exist in the manga and did come to him and ask him for vengeance for the death of her father, she also comes to him in this movie and asks for that, and that's basically the whole movie. It's him and this little girl teaming up, bonding, and getting the bad guy. And while that is a main part of the storyline in the manga has all these other twists and turns that take it in a million directions, whereas this movie plays it really smart and hyper-focuses on that plotline. This movie is way more about one man trying to make amends for failing his sister, by way of helping this little girl get vengeance for her father, as opposed to him making amends for simply killing 100 people. Now, I'm hoping I make sense, but I am sick, so my thoughts might not be 100% coherent, but hopefully you get what I'm saying. Anyway, I 100% recommend Blade of the Immortal. If you like Takashi Miike movies, if you like samurai movies, then this is 100% in your wheelhouse. It's super bloody, it's super heart-wrenching, and it's got some amazing fight choreography. And on top of its amazing fight choreography, it has an amazing rogues gallery of villains in this movie. That's the part of the movie that screams manga the most, the part where all the villains show up and their crazy weapons and their crazy gimmicks, and watching our hero, who while he can't die, still can be fucked up pretty hardcore, and you're watching as he's trying to figure out how to beat each villain and their individual quirks. That's pretty fun. That feels like 100% like you're watching a live-action anime. But not like one of those shonen animes, one of those old-school animes from the 80s and 90s that were super bloody and hardcore. Cause mind you, this movie is a hard R. There's blood, there's guts, there's rape, there's the whole nine yards of just depravity. Some of it is really fun to watch, some of it is intentionally hard to watch, but in the end, it is ultimately satisfying to watch our hero, despite all of his past sins, overcome all these obstacles. And the bond he forms with this little girl is just, oh man, it's adorable. It's precious. There are moments towards the end of this movie where I was in near tears because I was so moved by the relationship between these two characters. But with that, I feel like I'm saying too much. So as per usual, I'm going to include an Amazon affiliate link in the description below. And if you click that link and buy or rent the movie with that link, I will get a kickback from it. And with all that said, my fellow gorehounds, let us finally move on to the spoilers. Alrighty then, so we open up this movie with a prologue of our main character in the past just slaughtering all these assassins that have come to kill him because he essentially killed a whole bunch of samurai lords, including his sister's husband. And as a result of killing his sister's husband, his sister has gone crazy. So you have all these assassins that show up to kill him, and there's like 100 of them. But not only is he trying to protect his own skin, he's trying to protect his sister, but the assassins use his sister as bait. So he tries to bargain with them to give his life so that his sister can live. But the assassins kill his sister anyway, which causes him to Hulk out and kill all of them. And trust me, this is the kind of movie where you're gonna watch as one guy kills 100 people in the first 10 minutes of the movie. And none of these kills are gonna happen off screen. They're all gonna happen within the camera, and you're gonna see each and every one of them die. And it's this glorious ballet of violence like only Takashi Miike could direct. But what I like about it is that as he's killing these 100 men, he's also getting the shit kicked out of him along the way. So by the end of it, he's all kinds of fucked up. He's lost an arm, his face is all messed up, he's got wounds everywhere, he's bleeding out. And then this old lady shows up, and I can only describe her as a witch because I'm not quite sure what you would call her. But she's clearly some sort of ancient spirit that goes along and finds these warriors and curses them. So she puts this worm inside our main character's mouth, and this worm causes his entire body to heal itself. And so now, not only is he immortal, he's like Wolverine and can auto-heal everything. He can even reattach limbs that have been cut off. It's pretty fucking OP when you think about it. But what I like is the movie does a good job of having him struggle with everyone he comes across, so even though he is OP, you still kind of feel like he wins by the skin of his teeth every time. So it's like you have a character like John McClane who basically just kind of weasels his way out of every situation, except you know that he can't actually lose because he's immortal, yet somehow the movie still adds stakes. And that's something I want to commend the movie for. The movie still makes you feel like there's still something to lose, even if our main character can't die. But before we move on to the rest of the movie, I do want to say what I really like about this opening scene is that the entire thing is done in black and white. And as a result of this, it really does feel like you're watching an old Japanese movie like The Seven Samurai or Yojimbo. And right away, Miike's love for old school Japanese cinema just oozes from every orifice of this opening scene. Anyway, after the prologue, we flash forward 50 years, and we're introduced to a little girl whose dad runs this samurai dojo, in which her dad teaches their family's traditional sword fighting style. But in the middle of the night, this other dojo shows up, and this leader of this dojo, who's one of those kind of like effeminate Japanese villains, he shows up with his entire dojo and challenges her father, with the stipulation being you can either join us or die, but if you choose not to join us, you can fight us, and naturally, if you live and win, you don't have to join us. So anyway, her father fights the villain, and he ends up losing pretty badly. And the reason why he loses is because the dojo he's facing doesn't have a specific fighting style. The whole tenet of their dojo is that they're consuming all the other styles and allowing everything to be game, because the leader believes in victory by any means necessary. So after killing her father, the villain then gives the mother to the rest of her men to rape, with one of the men taking the little girl outside of the room so she doesn't have to witness her mom being raped, and this is what sets off the little girl on this journey of vengeance against this evil villain guy. And I love this, because we're only like 20 minutes into the movie, and the movie's about 2.5 hours long, and everything has been set up perfectly for everything to happen. Despite being a really long movie with a lot of ground to cover, it has incredible economy of storytelling. So anyway, in her quest for vengeance, the little girl ends up running across the witch who cursed the samurai at the beginning of the movie, and the witch tells her the story about the samurai who was so good he killed 100 men all by himself, and that rumor has it, this samurai cannot die. So armed with this knowledge, the little girl sets out to find this samurai and ask him to help her get vengeance for her father. Now the reason why I say vengeance for her father is because she's still operating under the belief that her mother's still alive. So naively, she kinda still believes she can get her mother back, which as you will find out over the course of the movie, she can't. So she successfully tracks down the samurai, but he initially refuses her offer, and this is despite the fact that she looks identical to his sister. So at first, he thought he was being cursed by the ghost of his sister coming back to torment him. But then he realizes, no, it's a little girl that just kind of looks like her. But here's the thing, despite whatever he thinks in his head, his heart is telling him something else. And this becomes clear when the little girl is attacked by one of the men of the evil villain, because it turns out the evil henchman who moved her out of the room when her mother was being raped is in fact a pedophile and is in love with her, and he wants to express his love by killing her. But more than that, not only is he going to express his love by killing her, he also has her mother's head on his shoulder. And this is the kind of movie in which her mother's head, despite being decapitated and on his shoulder, can talk. And it seems like this where Takashi Miike's love of horror cinema shines. Cause once her mother starts talking, it was just, oh man, my skin started to crawl hardcore. And this is another one of those moments in the movie where your heart starts to feel like it's being wrenched out of your chest because, oh my god, this little girl whose mom was raped in front of her now has to see the decapitated head of her dead mother talking to her and crying to her on top of the shoulder of one of the men that she thought was one of the good men who has now confessed his love to her and his plan to kill her. It's just all kinds of fucked up. But this is when our main character Samurai says, fuck that, shows up, and saves the day. Our main character gets his ass kicked in this first fight, and if it wasn't for the fact that he couldn't die, he probably would have lost. Because mind you, he spent the last 50 years as a hermit and hasn't touched the sword in a while. And unlike the assassins who attacked him 50 years ago, the people he's fighting now are master warriors. And each of them have mastered multiple styles, making them exceptionally dangerous. But he does win, and after this victory, he ends up taking the little girl's quest to kill the evil guy that killed her father. But after this point, the movie gets a little bit more complicated because it adds some other arcs from the manga into the movie. And despite them being super condensed versions, you never feel like they're being rushed. Like, for example, the big bad's main goal is to essentially unite all the dojos under his dojo, and in turn unite Japan under his ruthless rule. But there's a lot of people in Japan that don't want him to do this, not the least of which being the Japanese government. And they've basically hired this secondary group of warriors, which is composed almost entirely of criminals and murderers, and this group is essentially there to disrupt all the villain's dealings, but because of our main character and this little girl on their vengeance quest, they pin all of the kills they do on those two. So the evil guy thinks that our main characters are killing more of their men than they are. But our main characters don't find this out until about 3/4 into the movie. Because basically, after fighting a bunch of henchmen of this evil guy, they end up running into this group, and the main samurai is very hesitant to join them, but the little girl insists, so they do, and this ends up being a really big mistake. Because while teaming up with this group, they try to ambush the main bad guy, but it turns out it wasn't the main bad guy at all, it was a hooker they hired to look like the main bad guy. And when the head of the government-hired group tries to rape and kill that hooker, the girl tries to step in and stop him, and then he attacks the girl, which leads to our main character kicking his ass and cutting off his arm. Which leads to this guy running off on his own and basically becoming another entity that they have to worry about. So over the course of this movie, you have the main villain and all his henchmen, you have the government and their operatives, and you have this ex-government operative, rapist, murderer guy as well. And I'm not going to tell you exactly how because the movie is really good and I want you to see it for yourself, but eventually all of these plot threads culminate in the final act. And it is without a doubt one of the bloodiest endings to a Takashi Miike film since 13 Assassins. Just nonstop bloodshed, mayhem, awesome sword fighting, like just badass, top of the line action. People pull out awesome weapons, characters that you thought were dead come back and save the day. There's a bunch of backstabbing and treachery and just espionage. And on top of that, there are multiple moments, especially regarding the little girl and the samurai, that just tug your heartstrings something fierce. And with that all said, my fellow gorehounds, be sure to like, comment, subscribe, and don't forget to ring that notification bell so that you're notified of my videos immediately upon their upload. And as always, peace out, my fellow gorehounds, and I'll catch y'all later. God damn, 100 movies! That's insane!